Hello, I'm Professor Nicolae Bibu, and I will speak about today about culture and creative industries in the context of impact investment in culture and creative startups webinar. I will discuss this module in order to help you understand what the culture and creative industries means actually. And in order to do that, we'll cover some definition and also some relevant dimensions of the CCI sector in European Union. I will start by presenting definitions of what is culture. There are many definitions of culture, so we choose for you four of the most relevant definitions in the context of this project and subject. Well, first, culture is the customary beliefs, social forms, and material traits of a social, racial, or religious group. Or second definition defines culture as a set of shared attitudes, values, goals, and practices that characterizes an institution or an organization. Third definition focuses on the fact that culture is a set of values, conventions, or social practices associated with a particular particular field, activity, or societal characteristic. And the fourth one, culture is defined as the integrated pattern of human knowledge, belief, and behavior that depends upon the capacity for learning and transmitting knowledge to successful generations. And we have here also a model, very famous model, which is called the culture wheel, in which the nine components of culture are influencing each other and going through the wheel, they are enforcing each other during time, and so the value the culture becomes stronger and stronger each time. And it starts with values and moves to greater community and moves to knowledge and then to languages, to traditions and rituals, and then techniques, skills, and tools and objects that are used by people in that group. By their arts and food drinks, and we come back to culture, to values. So you see, it's a self-reinforcing model. Next, we'll discuss the definitions which are related to the cultural and the creative industries in the European Union conception approach, since we are a European Union project and countries. Cultural industries are those industries that produce and distribute goods and services that at the moment they are developed are incorporating a specific cultural attribute, use, or purpose, regardless of commercial value. While the creative industries are those industries that use culture as an input or have a cultural dimension, also their outputs are mainly functional. And in real life, these terms are used almost interchangeably. However, the notion of cultural industries emphasizes the cultural heritage and traditional and artistic elements of creativity, while the notion of creative industries tends to place emphasis on individual creative talent and innovation and on the exploitation of intellectual property. Regarding the importance of the CCE sector in Europe, its pillars are based on on four dimensions. Diversity, European Union and Europe in general benefits from its and very diverse cultural background, providing strengths in a globalized economy. Second, the pillar is innovation. Innovative solutions are needed today to face the current challenges. New approaches to growth are needed in order to respond to complex crises we are facing in Europe and also in the world. And third, technology and science. Innovation is widely recognized and as encompassing more than just technological and scientific innovation. Also, this is very important. In this saying that soft innovation and creative design processes are increasingly relevant in the in this context. And the fourth pillar is culture-based creativity. Cultural and creative industries, or CCIs, are active users of these new approaches, using culture-based creativity as a basis for developing innovative approaches for other sectors of the economy, which is increasingly becoming needed, as we already discussed. I'll present the next strategic framework for the cultural policy of the European Union. The cultural and creative sectors contribute to all six political priorities of the European Union for the period 2019-2024. First, an European Green Deal, striving to be the first climate-neutral continent. Second, a Europe fit for the digital age, empowering people with a new generation of technologies. Third, economy that works for people, working for social fairness and prosperity. Four, a stronger Europe in the world, Europe and European Union to strive for more by strengthening our unique brand of responsible global leadership. Fifth, promoting our European way of life, building a union of equality in which we all have the same access to opportunities. And finally, the sixth one, a new push for European democracy, nurturing, protecting, and strengthening our democracy in the current period and also in the future. I'll present next some cultural sector data regarding the European Union. First conclusion is that there is a strong and vibrant cultural creative industries in the European Union because they are not only essential for European cultural diversity, strengthening social cohesion, but also for increasing the Europe attractiveness internationally. And we can also affirm that they are among the continent's most dynamic sectors in the last period. In 2020, the cultural creative industries in the European Union have employed 7.2 million people, equivalent to 3.6% of the total workforce of in the European Union, which is quite a lot, representing 1.2 million enterprises. There are many key data about European Union cultural creative economy. I'll just present some of them. The level of revenues, the CCS represent 5.5% of the overall EU economy. About the links to other sectors of economy, the CCS generate important revenues linked to cultural tourism or festival, for the accommodation and food services, while for the ICT sector, the CCS are strongly interlinked with digital services, which represent a key component of the music and video game value chains. About the cultural jobs, on average, 32% of cultural workers are self-employed in the European Union, compared to 14% in overall employment, which indicates the fact that this approach of being self-employed is very strong in this type of industries. And finally, there is a life learning support for entrepreneurship, which is much needed because the life cycle of CCS relates very much to the careers of professionals in these sectors. And lifelong focus and support for entrepreneurship and innovation in the cultural and creative sector should relate to the careers of professionals in this sector. And also it should focus on all stages of the life cycle and not only on the startup phase. And we will discuss this issue later into this module. I will talk about mobilizing others. This module will help you learn how to mobilize stakeholders towards delivering environmental and social outcomes. In order to do this, we need to look to the environmental and social outcomes and the business. And we take the point of view that there is a need for a stakeholder-centric perspective for the business. The business needs to broaden their perspective about the corporate objectives of management. The most companies, business companies, still focus primarily on the bottom line of economic return, mostly financial. And that is a challenge to direct their attention towards social and environmental goals. It is clear that there are barriers for a business to go from a shareholder-centric, focusing on financial rewards for the investors, for the shareholders only, to a stakeholder-centric perspective, focusing on several categories of groups of people interested or affected by the business activities. It is one thing to intend to connect economic dimensions with positive social outcomes, and it is another to successfully couple financial results with social and environmental contributions. However, there are ways to do this, and one way is to create a partnership and show that there is a lot of room for partnerships between responsible startups and invest on one hand and the investors on the other hand. And so their hands are joined together in this endeavor. The responsible startups come with an offer of fresh product ideas and technologies, and they express a need for money for development of the company and the products. And also they express a need for sectoral and expertise in the business development. While investors, they are having the money and they come with their money needed, sectoral expertise and management knowledge, which is needed by the responsible startups, while their need of investors for fresh business idea and business proposal with development potential are coming for responsible startups. And this this interrelated interests and resources create a very strong basis for a partnership for responsible impactful investment. What is an investor looking for? It's very important to understand what they are looking for. And so when they look to a project, they are actually interested in some parameters. You have a list of them here. A return rate, financial return rate exceeding 20% each year. And for a new project, 60-90% each year, according to investor preferences. However, these are very high rate of returns. Second, they look for a combination of equity and debt instruments, which is allowing them as equity instruments to have a chance for an above average return on their investment, and for the debt instruments to ensure some protection against risk of investing in a startup company. Also, they look to financing in tranches, so in the whole investment will be divided in several tranches and will be provided at appropriate time during a longer period of time during the project. They are also looking for some possible control over the implementation of the project. They are looking for optimal investment because they are setting the minimum and maximum amount of their capital involvement. And if you want much more than they are willing to invest as a maximum amount, then will not be financed. And finally, they are looking to the fact that the project sector is corresponding to their preferences. And there are investors who are investing in creative industries, others that are investing in a specific field of cultural industries. And so there is a wide array of investors which might be interested in the subsectors of creative and cultural industries in Europe. There are very specific criteria also from venture capital as an investor perspective. They are looking for a high commercialization potential. of the market offering of the company. They are looking for a growth potential of the business and the project development level. Or it's a startup or it's an already established company and so on. They are looking very closely to project team quality and experience, which is very important in deciding after that parameters related to the commercial potential and the growth potential. And also they are looking for the intellectual property protection and to the market orientation of the business in which they are invited to invest. Venture capital is a very diversified sector. However, we can divide them in three types of major investors. One type is business angels. The business angels, they look could be full-time, so devoting all their attention to the company, or part-time, only for a certain period of time. And then they are investing in a portfolio, so they have several companies in which they invest. However, they are seeking income from their investment, and also they are seeking wealth maximizing for their companies, which in they have invested. About the VC funds and corporate funds, I will go into a more deeper detail. Venture capital funds are private equity investment vehicles that seek to invest in firms that have a very high risk but and a high return financial return profile. And this is based on company size and company's assets and the stage of product development. Capital funds differ, venture capital funds differ from other investment funds because they focus on a very specific type of, which is the early stage investment. So when the companies are at the beginning, all firms that receive venture capital investment have high growth potential, are risky, and also have a long-term investment horizon. Venture capital funds, they have a more active role in their investments. Because they are also able to provide guidance, and often they are holding a place, a seat in the board of directors of the company, and so they have a say in the decision making of the company. They have portfolio returns that resemble a barbell approach to investing. Many of these venture capital funds make small investments on a wide variety of young companies, hoping that at least part of them will achieve high growth and reward the fund with a comparatively large payout, financial payout at the end, and compensating therefore for the that investments who are not reaching this potential. They are also possible partners if because for cultural and creative sector companies. Because they are focused on investment, as I said already, focusing on early stage investments like seed investments, startups, early growth, and focusing on expansion investments and buyout acquisitions and buyout financing. And there is another type which are looking mostly for ownership focus, so to have ownership of the company in there, which are there investing. And these are mostly the private venture capital firm, the industry-sponsored firm, the state government sponsored venture capital firms, and also university-sponsored venture capital firms in some cases. A solution for an alternative solution for startups to mobilize resources are the public-private partnerships. For the small and medium company trying to grow, the economic development assistance can be found in three forms. The first one is technology and scientific grants. These are monetary or in-kind compensation offered by a public or a private source to advance a specific field of science and or engineering deemed important to the grantor. If a small business technology goals align well with those of the grant, then these funds can be used also to grow the business venture. The second way is represented by the government performance contracts. This type of assistance take public and private partnership a step further by creating a buyer-seller performance contracting relationship between a small business and a public institution. And third one is the economic development support. This is the process of utilizing public sector programs aimed at generating either job growth, either to optimize the company's underlying business climate, and on the front of a business growth, national and new economic development programs are very important because they bring discount financing, bring loan guarantees, infrastructure support, ensure workforce development, and also labor subsidies. So supporting these companies in order to achieve their goals. Also about public-private partnerships, it's important to look to the role of the partners. There are investors or investors, they provide the capital to service providers to achieve agreed social outcomes for the term of the contract, such as individuals, foundation, commercial banks, community development, financial institutions. Another actor is the funder, who is the one who ultimately pays for achieving an agreed outcome. Usually it is a government or an international donor institution. Third, there is a service provider, so is the one who delivers the program, for example, an NGO. Fourth, is the intermediary, which has a role to structure and coordinate the relationship between the parties, including the investors, funders, service providers, and so on. And finally, there is an evaluator, which is an independent third party who measures and or validates the outcomes of the agreement of the public partnership, public-private partnership agreement. In regarding the impact investment, there are four major groups of actors, which are the government, the impact investors, the social enterprises, and the society. Each of them has some important activities and roles to play. For example, government should define nationally and legally enforcing the concept of impact investment, to implement also performance reporting mechanism, to introduce incentive schemes, to act to reduce the interest bank deposits, to include mostly and also to include social entrepreneurship and impact investment subjects to the school curriculum, in the public schools, of course. For the impact investors, important are the identifying liabilities, networking and partnership with social entrepreneurs, having an interest and adaptation of new methods, waiting patiently for getting the desired financial return, and also invest more in seed and venture stages, so at the beginning of the life cycle of these companies. Social enterprises, they should have a robust business model and a revenue model. They have to show continuous commitment towards creating meaningful impact, to ensure the continuous growth, to improve their business literacy, to develop their business skills of their employees and management, being trustful and trustworthy, and also being open for negotiations. And finally, some issues, some stuff that a society should do. First of all, they should buy from social enterprises in order to sustain their activity, to be encouraged to make investment rather than depositing the money into the banks, to promote entrepreneurship at all levels of society, and also to supporting existing entrepreneurial activities on every level of the society. About the financing of CCI startups, which we show already that is the interest to do both for venture capital, both for private, public-private partnerships and other type of investors. Capital and access to finance are important in every phase, but financial support in the starting up phase is the most important. Sources of finances and financing instruments, of course, there are a long list. It differs from country to country as importance and use. However, we can see there are many of them: self-financing, bank loans, risk capital, seed financing, using public grants, using private grants, getting money from venture capital, and also listing on the stock market. However, a disadvantage for startups from the CCI sector is the fact that they often require a longer term to become profitable. And that creates a difficulty for investors because typically investors want a return on their investment in as little as 3 years. But in the case of CCI, this has been proved already. It's a too short period. Therefore, many countries in European Union are designing specific initiatives in support of startup and early stage funding aimed to support creative and cultural entrepreneurs and small and medium-sized enterprises. About the life cycle of the CCI, in the CCI, that is relating very much to the careers of professionals in these sectors. Their careers and their socio-economic positions are vulnerable, yet at the same time, they show to the others the direction in which the future labor market is developing. So the right innovation and entrepreneurship support incentives can push CCS careers forward and give inspiration to traditional economy entrepreneurs on how to deal with future labor market challenges within Europe. So European Union is paying a lot of attention to this issue. There are several stages within the CCS life cycle. Let's look to each one of them. So the seed idea stage, which is the first, is characterized by the fact that the professional develops an idea that he or she wants to turn into goods or a service offered to the market. Budgets usually are provided by the three Fs: friend, families, and fools. And no joke about that. Other potential sources are the suppliers, the customers, the government grants, and banks. Second stage is the startup or the structure stage. In this stage, a professional has already established his or her product or service which wants to sell to the market, has found his or her clients, for example, participants or audience, and also the workflow of delivering these products and services has been planned. Sometimes the mission and the vision are also developed, but the need for a strategic approach is not yet put into action. Next stage is the growth stage. In this stage, professionals, CCS professionals, can still be self-employed and choose to remain so because of some advantages like the necessary freedom and autonomy to reach their goals as they require, as they want. However, others are choosing business structures or not-for-profit structure organizations, and their daily activities are organized in a much more formal way now. There is a bigger audience and market which is needed, and therefore activities are planned to reach that goal. The fourth stage is the established or strategy stage. It's already the career professional is either self-employed, either has a business or founded a not-for-profit organization. The professional activity is at a mature state. The place within the ecosystem of the professional and the organization is clear, and the daily activity has become strategically, that means long-term oriented. And they have also found and known their customers or audience, They are continuous adaptation, adapting to the changing tastes of both the society and their clients, which is needed to stay relevant for this either society or their customers. The fifth stage is the expansion stage. This is a common phase in the traditional economy, but not always within the life cycle of CCS. During this phase, investment money is needed in combination with innovation and support. And also public support schemes remain a very important factor to obtain an ideal multiplier effect. Sixth stage is the maturity or festival stage. That's a stable, consolidated phase in which the content become increasingly important and strategic management stronger. There is a supporting network and innovative strategy development of the business or organization. And also in this stage, innovation and investment support are required to ensure the business organization futures. And the last stage, which is the exit stage, is usually done by selling the company. It is not working in traditional in CCS as in the traditional business, because most of the professional self-employed organizational micro or small companies, and so they have small profits. And very important, there is no continuity in the company without the presence or talent of the individual behind the creative company. And in this moment, there is a time to test the knowledge you have acquired. Are you ready? I will ask you a question, and then I leave you to find the right answer. Good luck. And the question is, stakeholder-centric corporate governance perspective assumes A, integration of stakeholder objectives into company objectives, B, integration of shareholders' objectives into company objectives, or C, exclusion of shareholders' objectives from the company objectives. Well, if your answer was A, integration of stakeholder objectives into company objectives, then you are correct. And however, if not, then please go through this video again to find the right answer and answer to the question in the right way. So good luck and keep in touch. However, with this, you finish the module. If you are interested into more information, you click on the button to download the booklet of this competence unit. You just participated. Congratulations. Also, you reached the end of this course. Please contact the organization that provided you access to the course to receive your certificate. Click on the resources area and available on the upper right corner for additional comments. End of course. Stop sharing. So that is the end of this recording and this webinar. I wish you good luck in your adventure. I wish you good luck in your career, professional career. And many successes you want to do. Goodbye.